How many of us are in Kingdom Life season? You don't sound excited. How many of us are excited and are already in the season of the Kingdom Life World Conference? Praise the Lord. Good morning, Big Mommy. Thank you so much, Ma, for this privilege. I don't take it for granted. And to our Father in the Lord, the presiding Bishop of TREM, Dr. Michael Konkwa, thank you, Daddy, for believing in us. Thank you for the trust that you repose in us, not in us, but in the gift of God upon our lives. We don't take this privilege for granted at all. This is a hallowed podium. Years and, you know, of dedicated sacrifice, commitment to the cause of the gospel have gone into building this, and we do not trample upon it. Thank you, Ma. Thank you, sir. In Jesus' name. Yes, church, please put your hands together for our Father and our Mother in the Lord. Praise the Lord. And to every leader in the house, my senior pastors, everyone, I trust that you're praying for me this morning, even as we delve into God's Word. God's Word is sweet, right? God's Word is sweet. God's Word is sweet. Job said it's sweet, sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Praise the Lord. Truly, you can feel Kingdom Life in the air, right? Yeah. It's a spirit. You can feel it's palpable. It's palpalpable. That's why that's why Evie Nation came this morning with fire. That's why Evie Nation came this morning with fire. The Lord bless and increase you all in Jesus' name. And every service unit actually is in top. Every service unit is at the top of their game. And we trust God that this week, starting from the 17th through the 24th, will be a time like we have never experienced before in Jesus' precious name. And like Pastor Oche was saying, the Kingdom Life World Conference is our festival. It's our festival. It's our festival. And if it's our festival, it connotes that we prepare for it. It connotes that we come looking glam and flashy. It connotes that every day you have proposed to be here. You know, like you're going for a party, you have your outfits, you plan, you curate every single thing because you know it's our festival. Growing up as a child, you know, through the 90s, even when we moved to Ibadan, coming down for Kingdom Life, you were looking forward to it, and you're packing your bag, you're packing your stuff. How many of us would be, if this is going to be your first time of experiencing Kingdom Life here, can I see your hand? Your first time. Please don't miss any session. Clear out your calendar. Be here in the morning and in the evening. I'll be looking out for you. When you come, look out for me too. Okay? Every day we can take pictures and we post and say day one, day two, day three, all the way. All right? God bless you. God bless you. And so, more importantly, you have to prepare your heart. As good as preparing your outfits, you must prepare your heart. Because, like we know, it's about us being in the right disposition or having the right disposition to receive from God. God is sitting down resting. He has done all that needs to be done. The difference between where he intends us to be and where we are is a matter of disposition, because your disposition is critical to what you can receive. Whether it's your heart disposition, how is your heart prepared for the Kingdom Life World Conference? I learned of someone who, every time you hear him say, "Oh, once the preacher starts talking, in 5 minutes, I can already tell where they are going." Such a person can't receive from God. Even if this cathedral is filled with angels, literally angels everywhere, he can't receive anything. Why? Because his heart is not prepared for it. So prepare your heart. Meaning that when you come to Kingdom Life, don't say, "I know where this pastor is going. I know how he teaches. I've heard him for years and years and years. I can already tell what he's going to say. I know he will do this. He will call for a seed. I've prepared myself." Ah, no, I know he will call a seed. Even if he does, if God is speaking to your heart, obey. If God is speaking to your heart, that's why you must prepare your heart. Because every time there is a convocation such as this, God speaks to us. God speaks to us. It's more about him speaking to us than us speaking to him. Because when we speak to him, yes, things can change by the way of, you know, answered prayers. But when he speaks to us, automatically things must change. So it's more about us receiving from him. So prepare your heart. Don't be over familiar with any session. Oh, I know morning session starts by 9. And it's for pastors. Okay, I'll come in by 10:30. You probably have missed something. Oh, evening session starts by 5. Okay, the studio opens 4:30. I'll target it. Praise will be by 20 minutes. I'll target it. 6 o'clock, I'll be there. They would have finished. You've missed something. Because every segment of each service will be a blessing to you. Whether it's the opening prayer, whether it's the praise worship session, whether it's the edify yourself, whatever part of it, God is not restricted to bless you using any particular segment. Every part of it, like Pastor Chi said, is packaged to be a blessing to you. Our Big Daddy and Big Mommy, the conveners of this conference, are particularly concerned and praying. And so for us as the headquarters church, we cannot, we know if we carry last too. In this case, now we worry you. Worry you, they carry last too. Now we don't turn worry so. You hear me? And we don't turn worry, so worry no they carry last. So we know if he carry last. Let it not be that others would imagine the anointings that would grace this house. The anointings that will grace this house, just this house. What if the Kingdom Life World Conference were holding in another branch, in another location? But it's here. In this same place where we gather. The anointings in this house, resting on this house. Don't trifle with it. Don't trifle with it. Tell yourself, I will not trifle with it. You're not saying it convincingly. Let Big Mommy hear you. I will not trifle with this Kingdom Life World Conference. I will be here. Morning, evening. Day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4, day 5, day 6, day 7, and day 8. Yeah, be here. Be here. Be here. Be here. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, just bow your heads in prayer. Father, we thank you for this season. Thank you for this time. We sit at your feet, Lord. Empty of ourselves, desirous that you fill us. Lord, we are not familiar with you, neither are we familiar with your word. And so we come like babes, hungry, thirsty for nourishment, asking that you feed us this morning. Let your word flow unhindered and do that which only you can do. I pray that every person who hears this word now and even into the future will be transformed by the simplicity and the power of your word. I thank you because you are speaking through my vocal cords. I thank you because you are thinking through my mind. I thank you because Jesus is glorified in this place. In the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 I'll be speaking to us on what I've titled Sonship. Sonship. The theme of the Kingdom Life World Conference is Jesus. The Bible says that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And so I'll talk to us this morning on sonship. Ephesians chapter 3 from verse 14 to 19 in the New King James Version. Paul writing says, "For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 2, I'll read it in three translations of scripture, in the King James Version first, then the Passion, and then Amplified Classic. It says, "Behold what manner of love the Father had bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." TPT. "Look with wonder at the depth of the Father's marvelous love that he has lavished on us. He has called us and made us his very own beloved children. The reason the world doesn't recognize who we are is that they didn't recognize him." Verse 2. "Beloved, we are God's children right now." Somebody say right now. We are God's children when? Right now. "However, it is not yet apparent what we will become. But we do know that when it is finally made visible, we will be just like him, for we will see him as he truly is." Amplified Classic. "See what an incredible quality of love the Father has given, shown, bestowed on us, that we should be permitted to be named and called and counted the children of God. And so we are. The reason that the world does not know, recognize, acknowledge us is that it does not know, recognize, acknowledge him. Beloved, we are, even here and now, God's children. It is not yet disclosed, made clear, what we shall be hereafter. But we know that when he comes and is manifested, we shall, as God's children, resemble and be like him. For we shall see him just as he really is." The Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Amen. What is sonship? Sonship, the Merriam-Webster dictionary defines sonship as the relationship between a son and a father. Sonship. It's a noun. Sonship. So who is a son? It's an offspring. A male offspring. Male offspring. But another definition of a son, male offspring, yes. But another definition of a son looks at that from the place of adoption. You can have a son by birth, natural conception and birth, biological, or you can have a son by adoption. So we would explore two areas this morning, because the Bible tells us that now are we the sons of God. So procreation is the way by which we have children biologically. Yes or yes? Sure, talk to me. Yes? Or did anybody fall from the sky? If you fell from the sky, please let me see your hand. Okay, if you were created in a lab, in a bag, can I see your hand? At least for now, science hasn't gotten there. Science hasn't perfected it yet to create human beings and stem cells, right? Or human beings through stem cells. Science hasn't gotten there yet. So every person who is born upon the surface of the earth, or rather, every person who exists upon the surface of the earth was given birth to. Praise the Lord. However, we also have sons by adoption, right? Or daughters by adoption. Now, when I talk about sonship, it's generic, because there is no male, there is no female in God. Praise the Lord. So procreation is the ability to produce young or offsprings, and is one of the five blessings that God released upon mankind in the beginning. He says, be fruitful, multiply, right? Replenish the earth, subdue it, and what? Have dominion. If your neighbor is dozing, just maybe the AC is too cool, just nudge them by the side, just nudge them by the side. Some people are, you know, the AC is just, that's kingdom life blessing. Praise the Lord. You know, so be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue the earth, and have dominion upon the earth. God released that upon mankind. But it was not just upon mankind. God released this blessing upon everything that he created, upon the plants, upon the fish of the sea, upon the birds of the air, like that he was saying, everything produces after its kind. So you see that God was the first person to think about sustainability and not our companies. So now the world has come up with ESG, environmental, social, governance, policies and all that, sustainability. Everybody's talking about sustainability, but God from the beginning put sustainability in place such that the world, that's why even your body, before you even take medication, your body tries to heal itself of every disease that it encounters. Your body, through the antibodies, fights a disease. Why? Because God has put sustainability in place. It's his blessing. It's his blessing. So God is wise and the source of all wisdom. Now, these methods of procreation between the plants and animals are unique. They are different. They are different. As it concerns us human beings, procreation, regardless of what man tries to do, procreation can only happen between a biological male and a biological female. Right? We see a lot of nonsense across the world and people trying to overturn what God, the principles that God has put in place. But procreation can only happen between a male and a female. Only between a male and a female. And for us as Christians, because that must always be our worldview, procreation should only happen between a man and a woman who have solemnized their matrimony and are married. That's our worldview. Now, that does not mean that you don't have situations where people have children outside of wedlock, right? But because Christianity, this is God's way. This is how it should be. This is God's way, that a man and a woman come into a committed relationship that is solemnized, that's recognized by the law of the land as well as the church, and then they can have children, they can procreate. Praise the Lord. And in that, science also helps us understand that in the process of procreation, the man contributes the XY chromosomes and the woman contributes the XX, right? Right? It's not a science class, but I always help us to think and help us to understand and see the realities of what it is that we live, even from scripture. It helps you to understand exactly what God is doing. Now, let me say this. For married couples, for people who are married, who are desirous of having children, the process to procreation is not fail-proof. The process to having children is not fail-proof. And by fail-proof, I mean it is not 100% guaranteed that when you and your spouse come together intimately, that you must have children from that intercourse. It's not 100% guaranteed. If it were, then the global population of just over 8 billion would be way more than that, given the number of times some of us engage in sexual intercourse. It means that at every point in time, as long as the conditions are in line, it's not every time that you produce or you have a child or you conceive a child. It's not every time. Right? So it's not fail-proof. Because there are some who have tried with all the conditions being there and they still don't have children. Now, when it comes to animals, animals don't engage, or animals don't mate, or rather, animals mate only for one purpose. Animals mate only for one purpose, and that's for procreation. But for human beings, there is the other side to it. You can derive pleasure. You can derive pleasure from engaging with your spouse. But for animals, it's only procreation. That's why today you have a multi-billion dollar industry just simply around animal husbandry and breeding of animals. You have people who are millionaires in dollars simply because they rear special breeds of animals, whether it's lions or dogs and all that. They are in serious money, making serious money. Making serious money. If you want the dog to mate with your dog, they say, this my breed is very expensive. Very expensive. And you pay a lot of money just for that. And what if it doesn't work? Because it's happened. It will not work. So nothing comes out of it and your money has gone. If you want that breed again to mate with your own dog, you pay again. So there is a thriving business created around breeding of animals. Praise the Lord. I once watched a video. I don't know how many of us saw that video. There were some lionesses that were, biting on and trying to kill a lion. Who saw that video sometime? Not too long ago. Who has ever seen that video? About four or five lionesses were trying to kill this lion. And there was a veterinarian who understands, the behavior of animals, lions, who said, because I read the comment section, sometimes don't just go off with what people are saying, try to look for educated opinions of what is going on to understand. And it was said that the lionesses were trying to kill that lion. Why were they trying to kill it? It sounds crazy, but they were trying to kill the lion because all of them respectively had been trying to have offspring with the lion, but it was impotent. He was impotent. He could not give them children. The lion was impotent, and so of what use are you to me? Because you know what? Lions are truly lazy. Many times it's the lionesses that go and get the kill. But the lions are lazy. So when the lionesses go out because they have children to feed, and so the motherly instinct within them. And they're saying, listen, of what use are you? It's not like you go and fend for us every day. It's not like you are the one that kills the antelopes and brings the meat. You're supposed to help us have children. If you cannot produce, my sister has tried, her mother has tried, her cousin has tried, me too have tried, my neighbor also has tried. You can't give us children. Of what are you? And they literally were killing, biting him at different points of his body. And the lion died. Oh yeah, they killed him. You're saying, but they killed him. The people that thought he was useful say you are not useful, and you are doing, They killed him. He's not useful. Some of us will be sentimental. I say, no, keep him, let him. We can pray for him. He can come back again. He said, no. This one no need prayer. This one will die, will die. Praise the Lord. Now, so when you understand, you see that some couples are blessed to have their children at will. To have their children at will. I know a story of a dear friend whose husband was away. He worked offshore, and so he would go off and come back. And it happened so beautifully that every time he would come back into town, they come together, and then she gets pregnant, and he's away for like another 6 months. And by the time he's back, she's close to her EDD, and she has the child. They do the naming. He stays with them for another few weeks, and then he goes again. By the time he comes back, he plants another one. And they're having their children at will. They're having their children at will. But there have also been cases, and it's the blessing of God. But has it happened to anybody here? Maybe don't raise your hand, because you might just be sitting beside your spouse. Have you had a child that you did not want? Have you conceived a child that you did not want? And it just happened mistakenly. Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. Think about it. Have you conceived a child that you really didn't want? In fact, you and your husband or you and your wife have said, sweetheart, this is the last one. You see, everything that you need to do to ensure that we don't have any other one, go and do it. Whether it is taking the pillow or whether it is IUD, whatever it is, go and do it. But after you have done all that you know to do, hey, it still happens. Fun fact, true life story. I have seen a situation where a couple conceived a child against their will, and the husband was mad. The husband was furious. He said, what? After we said it, look at Nigeria, T-Pain is doing this to me, and you are conceived it. In this economy, how am I going to do it? They conceived a child against their will. And he was upset. Now, not because the wife wanted to do it, but you know, sometimes women can be, you know. Today is my mom's birthday, right? Yeah? But one of my siblings, I won't say which one, she really wanted that one to be a girl so bad. She really wanted that one. I have four brothers. She really wanted that sibling of mine to be a girl so bad that she bought everything pink, 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 pink. When the child came through, she was disappointed. No jokes, she was disappointed. She dressed and said, you see, you must wear everything. You must wear the pink, you must wear the dress, you must. I wanted a girl, you must wear it. They say you are a boy, no problem, you must wear it. To satisfy. Well, you see, we're laughing now, but imagine where in most cases, right, you would imagine that the parents are able to move beyond that disappointment and create an environment wherein that child is properly nurtured and grows. Right? But in some cases, you have situations where the parents are not able to move past their disappointment, and so they deal with the child from the premise of the pain that he supposedly has brought into their lives. I didn't want you, an unintentional child. I didn't plan for you. You were not my will. Meaning that it is not every child that you see on the surface of the earth that was actually desired. In fact, there's a scientific research that says so. Yeah. A research that was conducted across 5 different countries: Ethiopia, Guinea-Bissau, Uganda, Malaysia, Bangladesh, and one more. That report put it that 40%, and these people, they sampled just under 70,000 women. 70,000 women. 40% of children, or rather 40% of their pregnancies, children that are born, were not intentioned. That's staggering. Meaning that out of 5, 2 were unintentioned. Out of 5, imagine, well, how many here now? Just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They say 2 were not intentioned. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 2 were not intentioned. We're not intentional. Unwanted. It's the Every Newborn in-depth research. It was done on pregnancy intention data completeness, quality, and utility in population-based surveys. An estimated 40% of pregnancies globally are unintended. This research surveyed 69,176 women of reproductive age in 5 health and demographic surveillance system sites in Ghana, Guinea-Bissau, Uganda, Ethiopia, and Bangladesh. Now, the responses that were surveyed were based on questions bordering on 2 things: on pregnancy intention in 2 ways, pregnancy-specific intention and desired versus actual family size. So you can say, at the point where yourself, you're going to get married, how many children do we want? Oh, I want three. Oh, I want two. Oh, I want four. And they eventually get married and they have six. What caused that disparity? What led to the disparity? It was questions like this, bordering on these things, that these 70,000 women were asked. And the survey answers were studied. And they came to that conclusion scientifically. 40% globally, 40%. That is staggering. That's staggering. So that tells me that human sonship is not completely intentional. Human sonship is not completely intentional. That child that you say, my son, you're gloating over that child now, but you probably didn't want that child. You were angry when your wife told you, honey, we're pregnant. What do you mean? What do you mean? No, you can't be serious. You must be joking. What do you mean? I thought we agreed now. But now, oh, this is my daughter. My daughter that makes me proud. Every time I see you, I'm just jumping. But when they told you that they were pregnant of her, you were crying. Human sonship is not entirely intentions. It's not entirely the desire of the father and the mother. Praise the Lord. Because you probably were bothering about another mouth to feed. You're bothering about school fees again. How will I start all over again? Raising this child. On and on and on and on. But we read in scripture, and that's where I'm going to. What then is the hope for the believer that we are now called children of God? We read through scripture. Now are we the sons of God. Now are we the sons of God? If human sonship, the path to human sonship is not completely intentional, is that the same with God? Did somebody force us on God? Were you forced on God? Is God tolerating you? Is God trying to put up with you? Are you a mistake with God? Or is God just managing you and saying, you know what, let me just manage this one. Are you an accident of spiritual birth with God? Because with man, there is a possibility, like we have seen. Are you a stray bullet with God? Are you a stray bullet with God? John chapter 3 from verse 3 to 6. In the King James Version and the Passion Translation. Jesus answered and said unto him, speaking to Nicodemus, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Passion Translation, Jesus answered, Nicodemus, listen to this eternal truth. Before a person can even perceive God's kingdom, they must first experience a rebirth. Nicodemus said, rebirth? How can a gray-headed man be reborn? It's impossible for anyone to go back into the womb a second time and be reborn. Jesus answered, I speak an eternal truth. Unless you are born of water and the Spirit, you will never enter God's kingdom. For the natural realm only gives birth to things that are natural, but the spiritual realm gives birth to supernatural life. Hebrews chapter 12 from verse 9 to 10, Passion Translation, it says, and isn't it true that we respect our earthly fathers even though they corrected and disciplined us? Then we should demonstrate an even greater respect for God, our spiritual father, as we submit to his life-giving discipline. Our parents corrected us for the short time of our childhood as it seemed good to them, but God corrects us throughout our lives for our own good, giving us an invitation to share his holiness. John 20 from verse 16 to 17, Passion Translation still, Jesus was speaking. He says, Mary, Jesus interrupted her. Turning to face him, she said, Rabboni, Aramaic for my teacher. Jesus cautioned her, Mary, don't cling to me, for I haven't yet ascended to God, my Father. And he is not only my Father and God, but now he is your Father and your God. Now go to my brothers and tell them what I've told you, that I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God. So we see the fatherhood of God over us. God is my Father. Say boldly to yourself, God is my Father. So how did God become my Father? By putting my faith in Christ Jesus. Through faith in Christ Jesus, I have become a son of God. I have become a child of God. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 to 27. Or rather, just 26. It says, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. ESV says it this way. It says, for in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. Passion Translation says, you have all become true children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. The word there, son or children, is the Greek word, huios, speaking literally to us as children of God. And it was used, hear this, in the adoption and inheritance laws in first century Rome. And it refers to us all as children of God, whether male or female, all Christians, all who have put their trust in Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 4. I'm reading all these scriptures so that I set the tone for the next set of things I'll be saying. Galatians chapter 4, from verse 4 to 7 in the Passion Translation. But when the full time of fulfillment had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Yet all of this was so that he would redeem and set free those held hostage to the law, so that we would receive our freedom and a full legal adoption as his children, and so that we would know that we are his true children. God released the spirit of sonship into our hearts, moving us to cry out intimately, my Father, my true Father. Now we're no longer living like slaves under the law, but we enjoy being God's very own sons and daughters. And because we're his, we can access everything our Father has, for we are heirs because of what God has done. So, this scripture says that God did all of this to set us free, those who have been held hostage to the law, so that we would receive our freedom and what? Full legal adoption as his children. So the way of sonship in God through Christ Jesus is by adoption. It's by adoption. Breaking news. Child of God, hear this. Adoption is more intentional. Adoption is more intentional than the process of procreation. Adoption is more intentional. You cannot have an adopted child by error, by mistake. I can conceive and have a natural biological child out of my will, against my will, like we know. But you cannot have a child by adoption except you really want that child. Because it is more rigorous to adopt a child through intercourse. Intercourse is pleasurable, right? You're deriving pleasure while creating a child, right? But you go through strain, stress, rigor, pressure to adopt a child. And you want to imagine, why am I going through all this? Just to have a child that I'm going to nurture. It's not like the child is going to come and start adding value to me. I'm the one going to take care of that child. I'm the one going to nurture the child. I'm the one going to be responsible for that child. The child changes my entire life. But I go through the rigor to get that child. The intention. I'm not put off by the pain. I'm not put off by the rigor. I'm not put off by the stress it's going to create on me. How many times I have to visit the government? How many forms I have to fill? They have to come and check my house every day. They have to check myself and my spouse and say, are we okay? Can we take this child in? The government will check every single thing. They literally would scan a toothpick through your life to be sure that you can actually take care of this child. But who comes to the woman down the street when she has a baby to say, can you take care of the child? Who cares about that? Oh, you know, don't go on. Well, I don't know. But the moment you want to adopt a child, they are scanning you. They are checking you. They are checking you. You only have 1 million. But the woman down the street just has her bonny business that is making her 1,000 a day. But she has 7 children. Who cares about that? But the moment you want to adopt a child, the moment you want to adopt a child. And guess what? You can't say you want to adopt a child today and tomorrow you have the child. Yeah. You can't say you want to adopt a child today and next week you have the child. Some of us have to wait months. Some people have to wait years. The process is arduous. The process is stressful. But you're going through with it for the joy that one day you will call that child my son or my daughter. You're going through because, like Jesus, he endured the cross because he saw you and I afar off and said, one day I will call them my brothers. So I go through the stress. I go through the rigor. I go through all that. So because as I've seen that child, what has happened? I have loved the child. I've spoken to people who have adopted children. And they tell you, from the moment I set my eyes on that child, I had this connection. I just loved him. And so that love drives that person. So right now, yes, they might be feeling the pain. It might seem stressful, but they're going through it. Why? Because they're powered by love to go through the adoption process. They're powered by love to go through the adoption process. To go through the adoption process. They're powered by love. And guess what? If it takes that long a time for local or subnational adoptions, imagine for international adoptions. Where they will check you, is this not child trafficking? Are you not trying to traffic this child across borders? They will look at you, they will ask Interpol to do a survey of you from when you were little. Everything you have done throughout your life, they want to know. Because you're adopting a child across borders. They want to know. So when you think about this, now imagine the stress and strain that God had to undergo just to get you as his own. To be able to call you his adopted son, or rather, to be able to call you his son, because in Christ you have come, you have received sonship by adoption. God went through stress and strain to get you, and I'm going to show you that God can call us children today. He underwent a lot. You know why? Because from the point when Adam and Eve fell in the Garden of Eden, To the point of Noah's flood, when the entire world was destroyed, it took 1,656 years. 1,656 years. When Noah came out from the ark and God restarted earth with him, from that point on to the birth of Christ, was 2,408 years. In all, God spent 4,064 years on the waiting line. You know, it can get so difficult that when you want to adopt a child, the government authorities will tell you, I'm sorry, we have so many people on the waiting line. So you've not even started the process of adoption. You've not even gotten to a point where you see a child and you say, I want this one. You're just on the queue, waiting for them to say, oh, we might just have a child for you. God is there, waiting. 4,064 years on the waiting line until the birth of Jesus. Until the birth of Jesus. When the message came to the shepherds and said, the Christ is born. The Christ is born. And so from that moment, the process of adoption began for you and I. And guess how long it took? Another 33 and a half years. The process of adoption. So now God had moved from the waiting line. The process of adoption had begun. Jesus the Christ in the flesh, walking through the earth and fulfilling ministry up until the point on the cross where he said, it is finished. And he gave up the ghost. And he gave up the ghost. He gave up the ghost. God went through all this. God went through all this so that he can call you his own. You that man, you've only just been on the waiting line for 3 months, 4 months, you're getting agitated. You're only going through your own adoption process. It's taking you 1 year. You're getting agitated. But see how long God waited. His love kept him on the line. Waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting to the point where he'll be able to call you his own. God waited. God waited. God waited. His love, boundless love, his love, unconditional love, his love, irrevocable love, his love, irrepressible love, unconditional love, kept him on the waiting line because he saw you and he saw me. He saw us. He saw us. And you know what? Our own adoption was an international adoption. You doubt it? Colossians chapter 1, from verse 12 to 14, Passion Translation. Or King James first, and then Passion. Let's look at it together. Giving thanks unto the Father. Or let's read together. 1, 2, 3, go. Giving thanks unto the Father, which had made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Verse 13. Who had delivered us from the power of darkness and had translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. What did you see there? What do you see in verse 13? Put the verse 13 on screen. Who had delivered us from the power of what? Darkness, and had translated us into the what? So we change kingdoms, international adoption. Passion Translation, please. It says, your hearts can soar with joyful gratitude when you think of how God made you worthy to receive the glorious inheritance freely given to us by living in the light. He has rescued us completely from the tyrannical rule of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom realm of his beloved Son. For in the Son, all our sins are cancelled and we have the release of redemption through his very blood. It was an international adoption. God, they checked God. But God stayed the line because of you. He waited because of you. He thought you worthy. A cross-border adoption. It cost God everything. It put him under the greatest strain. Why do you think Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, "My Father, if it be your will, let this pass over me. But not my will, but your will be done." Is it possible? Why? It was the greatest strain that Jesus will suffer hematidrosis. It's a medical condition that Jesus will suffer hematidrosis. Hematidrosis, there are doctors in the house, you can confirm. Hematidrosis is a function of unusual stress. So that you are so under stress that your blood vessels, your capillaries burst and blood starts to come out through your glands, your sweat pores. Jesus suffered that. It was the greatest strain that the Son of God, who became the Son of Man, suffered for your sake and my sake, going through that process of adoption so that he can call you fellow brothers. He told Mary, "Go to my fellow brothers. Tell them that I'm going to my God and their God. I'm going to my Father and their Father." It cost him everything. It cost him everything. It cost him everything. It cost him everything. So then, why would you devalue? Why would you trifle with this sonship that you have received? Why would you trifle with your sonship? Why would you undervalue? Why would you esteem lightly what he did for you? Imagine that you have an adopted child and you know the stress and strain that you underwent to get that child. You know the sacrifices you've made to give that child the quality of life that they have. And they turn around and look you in the face and spit at your face. That's just on a human level. Then imagine how God feels every time we trample under feet the sacrifice of his Son. It cost God everything. It cost God everything. It cost him everything. That you can boldly shout Jesus, that you belong to Jesus today. Like my father would say, grace is not cheap. Grace is not cheap. The fact that you don't pay for it does not mean it didn't cost somebody something. It cost God everything. He waited on the line for over 4,000 years, waiting for you. The process of adoption, after being on the waiting line for 4,000 years, on the waiting line, just waiting. He did not lose patience. The patience of God. The patience of God. Long-standing, long-suffering. With us. With us. The patience of God. The patience of God. The patience of God. It cost God everything for you to treat your sonship rights with levity. And that's why at every convocation or every opportunity you have to further enrich yourself with the realities of your sonship in Christ Jesus, you don't take it for granted. That's why you cannot afford not to be at the Kingdom Life World Conference, because it's a convocation where your rights are being discussed, where you are being elucidated about the truth of who you are in Christ. You have sonship rights. You read it in scripture. As he is, so are we. We do not yet know the manner, the nature, the form we will take when he appears. But we know, however which way it will turn, that we shall be like him. We know. Because now are we the sons of God. Every opportunity to gather around and feast on the world and enrich ourselves in the reality of who we are in Christ Jesus, you don't trifle with it, because it helps you to understand who you are, and it shows that you appreciate all that God went through just to call you his own. I'm not not saying attend Kingdom Life because we want to have a full cathedral, as beautiful as that is. But you see, the vision of this house is to raise a people to live the kingdom life here on earth. And if you are not found at occasions or convocations such as the Kingdom Life World Conference, such as a Tuesday service, such as a Celebrate Jesus service like we are in today, how then do you want to live the kingdom life here on earth? Especially in a day and age like today, where evil is out of the closet, is staring you in your face, kuru kuru, how then do you face? Like Jehoshaphat, who the word of God had come to in verse 14, and he's still hearing the vandal horde out there. If he did not know his stance in God, he would have quit. But he maintained his stance because he knew that God cannot fail. He maintained his stance even with the noise. They still went out because God said, I am with you. This is my will, not your will. So why will I trifle with my sonship rights? Why will I trample underfeet the sacrifice of the Son of God? Why will I not be there? Why will I not be there? Why will I not? You're not doing me a favor. You're not doing your pastor a favor. You're not doing Big Mommy a favor. You're doing yourself a favor. You know why? Because the devil doesn't like you. And even if you were serving him, he still hates you. That's one of the things I've come to, and it boggles my mind somewhat, that the people who have given themselves off to be used as vessels in the hands of Satan, he hates them. But they don't know. They think they are serving his purpose, but he hates them. He hates every human because humans are created in God's image. And it's a privilege he does not have. So why? Why would you not? Why would you not? Take advantage. Why would you not? Be all that he has called you to be, knowing the price that he paid, knowing what it cost him to be able to call you his own, knowing what he underwent just to have you. Adoption, like I said earlier, is more intentional. If 40% of children were unwanted or not intentioned, there is no way you can say God was not intentional about getting you. The Bible says, he has put the spirit of adoption into our hearts, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. That's the depth of the intentionality. So sonship is the greatest outcome of the greatest demonstration of God's love. The greatest demonstration of God's love was Jesus hanging on the cross. But he was not just hanging on the cross for the mere reason of hanging on the cross. He hung on that cross so that you and I could come into relationship, a relationship of sonship with the Father. That's the greatest outcome. It's not, Jesus did not hang on the cross because he wanted to heal you. No. Healing is a byproduct of your sonship. Provision is a byproduct of your sonship. Security, preservation is a byproduct, a consequence of your sonship. The greatest outcome of the greatest demonstration of God's love for mankind is sonship. Celebrate your sonship. Celebrate. See, the devil would always make you try to underestimate what God has done in your life, because he cannot but tell you a lie. The devil will never tell you the truth. So if he tells you that, what are they talking about as you're listening to him now? What does he say? I better forget the guy. He knows how many things they talk. The devil will never tell you the truth, no matter how he tries. John 8:44 makes that very clear. He is the father of lies. And he lies out of his nature. Out of his nature. Sonship. So as we prepare, as we count down to the Kingdom Life World Conference, it's a convocation of sons. Did you hear me?
It's the convocation of sons. We don't come begging. We have rights and privileges. It's the convocation of sons. And where inheritances are being shared and given out, don't be left out. Don't be left out. Don't be left out. You have every reason to be selfish on this one. Forget your neighbor to your left and to your right. Be selfish in this one. Everybody answers their own name, not even their father's name. You answer your own name. Yeah. Because I cannot receive a blessing for you. You answer your own name before God. Because he knows you individually. Your spouse might want to say, I can't make morning session and I can't be doing morning and evening. And you say, okay, babe, that's you, babe. Me! I have an appointment with God. I have an appointment with God. Sonship perfectly captures the measure of the depths and the width and the breadth and the height of God's love. It reaches down to the depths of our flawed, sinful lives, and it exalts us to the dizzying heights of royalty and dominion in Christ Jesus. So when you read, like we read the first scripture, Ephesians chapter 3, from verse 14, or rather from verse 17 now, in the Passion Translation, to understand the breadth, the length, the width of God's love is all encapsulated in your sonship. Because that's how he relates with you. Like I said from the very beginning, sonship is a relationship between the Father and the Son. He pours it out. He lavishes it upon you. Why? Because you're a son. You're a son. Romans chapter 8 from verse 14. Romans 8 verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not yet received, but you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. 17. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be glorified together. Look at this. No, go back to 17. I'm stopping at 17. Put 17 in Message Translation, please. And we know we're going to get what's coming to us. What does he say next? Who wants to get an unbelievable inheritance? Then you cannot afford to miss out being here for the Kingdom Life World Conference. And we know, I'm not second guessing. I'm not doubting. I'm not vacillating between maybe, maybe not. And we know there's a guarantee. There is an assurance. We know we are going to get what's coming to us. Why do you know? Because you're a son. Why do you know? Because you're a son. An unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. Passion Translation. I'm stopping at 17, I said. Passion Translation. And since we are his true children, we do what? We do what? We do what? Don't you ever allow the devil tell you again that you don't qualify. Since we are his what? True children. How do we become his children? By adoption. An intentional, deliberate process. We qualify to share all, not some, not most, all his treasures. For indeed, we are heirs of God himself. Stand to your feet this morning. Celebrate. Celebrate your sonship. Celebrate your sonship. Celebrate your sonship. Celebrate that you are a son. God is intentional about you. You're not a stray bullet. You're not an accident of birth with God. God is not tolerating you. He went out looking for you. He went through all that stress and strain just to get you. And so he will not treat you with levity. Jesus told them, he says, if you men, he said, your son would not come to you asking for bread and you give him a stone. No, your son would not come to you asking for fish and you give him a serpent. No, he says, if you being evil know how to give good gifts, how much more your Father in heaven? He says, if he who spared not his only son, but gave him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? He will give you all things because you are a son. You are a joint heir. For the next 30 seconds, just talk to your Father. Tell him that you are his son. Thank you for making me your son. Thank you for making me your son. Thank you for making me your son. Thank you. I celebrate my sonship. I celebrate my sonship. I celebrate my sonship. I celebrate. I thank you. I thank you. I qualify. I qualify to share all your treasures. I qualify. I have a glorious inheritance. I have an inimitable inheritance. I qualify. Thank you, Lord. 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 I will not be found missing. I will not be found missing. I will not be found missing. I will not be found wanting. I will not be found wanting. I will not be found wanting. I am a son. I am a son. I am a son. You are deliberate about me. Thank you for being intentional with me, Lord. Thank him for being intentional with you. You are not an accident of birth with God. God went out looking for you. He went out looking for you. Jeremiah 31 verse 3 in Message Translation. When Israel thought they were out in the wilderness, it was God who was actually out there looking for them. They met God. Yeah, go from verse 2, please. Go from verse 2. It says, this is the way God put it. They found grace out in the desert. These people who survived the killing, Israel, out looking for a place to rest, met God out looking for them. God went out looking for you. God told them, I've never quit loving you and never will. Expect love, love, and more love. You're a son.
In my soul, it's free. Oh, it's free. I'm a child.
I'm a child.
Yes, I am.
Yes, I am.
Speak that to yourself.
In my Father's house, there's a place for me.
Anyone in this house, on site as well as online, if you've not met Jesus or made him the Lord of your life, I want to give you an opportunity this morning. I want to give you the opportunity to come into the relationship of sonship with your Father, with the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. He is King over the earth. He is God over the earth. But today he can be your Father. And if you want to make him your Father and make Jesus the Lord of your life, please, can I see your hand up? Can I see your hand up across this building? If you're also online, this is a call to you as well. Anybody in this house desirous of making God your Father and becoming a son to him? Any hands? Any hands? I know your heart's trudging in your heart right now. In the valley of decision, do I want to come out in front of everybody? Listen, beloved, we've all had to come out one day or the other. It will be no different. Everybody here loves you. Everybody here is praying for you that you come and be a part of this family. So don't be ashamed. Lift that hand. Stand up. Like I said, the devil will only tell you a lie. He probably is telling you now that you're too messed up to be saved. You're too messed up to be delivered. You're too messed up to be rescued by God. But that's why Jesus came. That's the love of God. That's what I was describing, the depth of God's love. He goes to the very depths of your mess, and he pulls you up from that mess and sets you up at the dizzying heights of royalty. That's what Jesus does. Can I see that hand? Can I see that hand? I know you are listening to me. Yes, come. 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 You are the reason Jesus came. You are the reason Jesus came. You are the reason he came. If it's for you only that this service was organized, stand up, my brother. Stand up. Is anybody else joining him? Anybody else joining him? I'm about to pray. If you're online as well and you've indicated on the comment section, please repeat this prayer after me. Know that this is the greatest day that you've ever lived. The greatest day ever. It's about to get beautiful in your life. My brother, say this prayer with me from the depth of your heart. Mean it, okay? Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I acknowledge that I am a sinner. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I cannot save myself. That is why I have come. Today, I believe that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to this earth to die for my sin. On the cross, he was nailed for my sin. He was buried, and on the third day, he rose for my justification. Today, I believe, and I receive you, Lord Jesus. I receive you, Lord Jesus, into my heart as my Lord and my personal Savior. I declare that I will serve you all the days of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. Amen. So, Father, on the confession of faith that he has made, as Jesus as his Lord and Savior, as the church, we stand and declare that his sins are forgiven and declare that he begins to partake of the inheritance of the saints in the light. The sonship rights now accrue to him. In the name of Jesus Christ. Satan, your hand is off this life. in the name of Jesus Christ, this one belongs to God. He will serve Jesus all the days of his life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, my brother, congratulations. Congratulations. What has happened to you today? Look at me. Is the best thing, yes. You believe God. You will experience a transformation in your life. And so as a church, we're here to help you. We're here to guide you. We have our counselors that you will follow. They'll ask you questions and help you to understand what has happened. Okay? So give them your right information and we'll continue to pray for you in Jesus' name. God bless you. God bless you. Church, please clap for him. Even for those online, if you have received Christ as your Lord and Savior, please do well to put your name in the comment section and we'll have our team reach out to you. In Jesus' awesome name we have prayed. In Jesus' awesome name we have prayed. Come here. Thank you. Hallelujah. Okay, can we rise and we have the communion in our hands? Praise the Lord. He says, do this as often as you do so in remembrance of me. And so, Father, we thank you for the communion elements in every hand. We thank you, Lord, because these represent your body and your blood. And as we partake, it reminds us of the price that you paid, the process that you went through just to be able to call us your own. We appreciate you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. And he broke the bread and he said, this is my body broken for you. Do this as often as you do so in remembrance of me. So take the body. And eat. Don't worry, I'll eat my own body later. Praise the Lord. It's not coming through. It's not coming through. Take, eat in Jesus' name. Amen. In the same vein, he took the cup and he blessed it. He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Drink the cup and thank him for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Heavenly Father. For what he underwent, just to be able to call you his son. Can you bring forth an offering that truly expresses the thoughts of your heart to him? The appreciation for what he went through just for you. 4,064 years, he was on the waiting line. And the process of adoption started and lasted for 33 and a half years. Just for you, he did not stop. He did not stop. He went through all the strain and stress for you so that he can call you his own. What can we give to appreciate this God? What can we give to appreciate him? What can we give that truly captures what he did for us? How much can you give? How much can you give? Nothing is too much. Nothing is too big. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. If you prepared that offering, please rise up to your feet. Much more than that money, much more than the amount, is also your heart, the disposition of your heart towards him. When you read in Galatians 6 and verse 9 that God loves a cheerful giver, it doesn't mean that it will not be sacrificial. It can be sacrificial, but the disposition and the attitude with which you are giving it is one of joy. It doesn't mean that every giving you're going to give is going to be pleasant, because God will make demands of us, not because he needs our money, but because he wants to check if we truly trust him. So if he's putting a demand on your heart to go out of the ordinary, please do so. It's always a question of trust. It's always a question of trust. We answer that question of trust every time. Every time. Not just in your financial giving, but in the obedience to the instructions that God gives us. Trust. Praise the Lord. The details are on the screen if you want to do your transfers. Praise the Lord. Lift it up before him. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the privilege of giving to you today. We honor you, we exalt you, because you are the one who gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater. We thank you because this seed goes forth and does your bidding. It's a reflection of our appreciation to you. And we thank you because you have received it of us, because you have received us even in the beloved one, Jesus Christ. We give you all the glory and praise. In Jesus' awesome name we have prayed. Amen. Celebrate your offering. Hallelujah. No solution.